because I was
This call is now being
preoccupied, because of
recorded.
some official preoccupations. I could not attend you in time. Sorry for keeping you waiting. So today we will discuss about the legal environment of a business, legal aspects of the business environment, not only legal, also the legal and regulatory aspects of the business environment is the topic that we are going to discuss today. And from tomorrow or even today, you can give some you can note down certain points which you have gone through at home and which you are not being able to understand. So you bring it to my notice so that I will try to clarify your doubts in the subsequent classes, which we are going to take tomorrow or the day after. Am I audible to all of you?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So you must have gone through your study materials and on business environment. And if you are having any doubts anywhere from any block, you note it down and you share those points with me so that I will clarify them tomorrow or in subsequent classes. So today we are going to discuss about the legal aspects of the business environment. In fact, the government, there is a term that is called laissez-faire economy. Laissez-faire, LASSIZFAIRE, laissez-faire economy. Laissez-faire economy means here the government does not play any role, except that means the trade and business activities are allowed to be carried out freely without any government intervention. And the government's role is confined to simply maintenance of law and order. And the government will mainly, it will act as a facilitator. It will promote the growth and development of industries. It will act in a manner which will facilitate or which will promote the growth and expansion of business activities in the economy. So in fact, the role that is being played by the government can be broadly classified into four categories. Yes. The role that is being played by the government can be classified into four categories. Those are government plans, government promotes, government also encourages entrepreneurship in the country, and it regulates the business activities in the country. So as far as business environment is concerned, the role that is being played by the government can be divided into four types of role. The role of planning, government plans for the promotion, plans for the industrial and industrial growth of the country. It formulates policies, rules and regulations for the growth of trade, commerce and industry. So policy making or planning, that is making law, these are the different planning role that is being played by the government for the growth of trade and business activities in the economy. Then promotional role. Government will facilitate the promotion of industries, trade, commerce in the economy. Promotional role. Entrepreneurial role means here the government will promote entrepreneurship. Why entrepreneurship is important in a country like India? You must be knowing that Indian economy is characterized by scarcity of capital and paucity of labor. Abundance of labor. Government, there are four factors of production, all of you know: land, labor, capital, and entrepreneurship. You must have been taught about the four resources of production or four factors of production in economics. So, among these four factors of production or four resources of production, Indian economy is characterized by scarcity of capital. Capital is a very scarce resource. Finance is a very scarce resource in a country like ours, in an economy like India. And there is abundance of labor or easy availability of labor, labor force. So, the characteristics of the economy, Indian economy being what it is, always entrepreneurship is considered to be one of the most important drivers of economic growth in India. All that means whatever policies and rules and regulations which are being framed for the growth of trade, commerce and industry, it must be done keeping in mind the promotion of entrepreneurship in the country. Because when a large number of small and medium enterprises will come into existence or it will be set up, it will facilitate the economic growth. It will create employment opportunities and more and more number of people will get employment. They will get opportunities for earning their livelihood, and they will be able to live a better standard of living. And setting up of or establishment of micro, small and medium enterprises, it requires less amount of capital. They are less capital intensive, but they are more labor intensive. Their employment potential is more. So that's why the government must promote or encourage entrepreneurship in the economy. It must promote entrepreneurship in the economy. So that's why the government will also have to play a role which will facilitate the growth of the MSME sector, micro, small and medium enterprises in the society. That will facilitate the growth, that will accelerate the process of economic growth. And another role that is being played by the government is regulatory role. Regulatory role means here the government will ensure that the trade activities, growth of industries, growth of trade, commerce and industry are taking place in a very rational manner. The economically backward regions should be given more importance. They should be brought to the mainstream of development. Adequate employment opportunities must be provided to the people. Whenever an industry or a business is going to be set up, business house is going to be established, it should provide employment opportunities for the local people. the trade, commerce and industry must not do any harm to the ecology or ecosystem of the area in which it is operating, in which it is carrying out its business activities. So all these are to be ensured by the government, and that's why the government will have to play regulatory role. So in order to enable the government to play these four types of role: planning role, promotional role, entrepreneurial role and regulatory role, the government will have to implement several laws, acts, rules and regulations. So that is how the study of the legal environment of the business is considered to be very relevant, or it is considered to be very significant in business environment. So there are different types of laws or acts, and all these acts can be broadly divided into certain categories, and they are the regulatory aspects or the laws which are enforced in our country in order to facilitate the growth of trade, commerce and industry in the economy. They can be broadly classified into three types. The regulatory aspects in the business environment can be each consisting of three types. Those are: number one, government policy; two, institutional agencies; three, laws relating to business activities, basic business law. Those are known as basic business law. That means the legal aspects of the business environment can be broadly summarized into these three points. Government controls the activities of the business through proper planning, through policy formulation, through issue of several instructions, directives, guidelines. So these are policy matters, or the government policy is one of the key elements of the legal aspects of the business environment in a country, particularly in a country like India. So the legal aspects will be consisting of these three elements: number one, the government policy; number two, the institutional agencies. There are many institutional agencies which have been existing in our country, which are working in our country for the control of business activities, like the Reserve Bank of India, then Reserve Bank of India, then NABARD, then TRAI, Telecom Regulatory Authority of India, then SEBI, Security and Exchange Board of India, then your IRDA, Insurance Regulatory Development Authority of India. So in this way, several institutional agencies are also existing, which are existing in our country. They have been set up in order to control the activities in a particular sector of the economy, in a banking sector or insurance sector or telecom sector. In different sectors of the economy, the activities are required to be controlled, and these control measures are exercised through different institutional agencies, as I was telling you, like in Reserve Bank of India, then NABARD, then your IRDA, TRAI, TRAI, then SEBI, etc. Then basic business laws. So the three important aspects of the legal environment of a business are the government policy, then institutional agencies, and the basic business law. So what is the, how the government through its policy...
Sir, basic business?
Yes,
third point.
Basic business laws.
Aye.
Basic business law. I am coming to it. We will discuss about it in detail. I am discussing one by one. First, let us discuss about the first aspect of the legal environment of a business, that is the policy aspect. Here the government formulates policies. It issues guidelines. It issues instructions and directives to the different sectors of the economy in order to regulate the activities. Let us suppose one of the most important policy of the government is, that means suppose the government wants that more amount of money should flow to the agricultural sector of the economy. So this is a national policy. The government, the policy of the government is to promote, suppose the policy of the government is to promote agricultural sector. Then agricultural sector need to be given financial accommodation. More amount of money should flow to the agricultural sector. So how it will be possible? So it will be possible through some institutional agency. Which institutional agency here will play a very vital role in enabling more amount of fund to flow to the agricultural sector? The Reserve Bank of India. So the Reserve Bank of India will issue instructions and directives to all the commercial banks in the country that they must all the banks in the country will have to earmark a certain portion of the gross bank credit to be given to the agricultural sector. So then the banks will start giving credit to the agricultural sector. Suppose the Reserve Bank of India will issue an instruction to all the commercial banks in the country that 40% of the gross bank credit must flow to the priority sector of the economy. Priority sector, some sectors are categorized or they are classified as priority sectors, like your MSME sector, micro, small and medium enterprises sector, agricultural sector, then housing sector, then financial accommodation to the small businessmen, self-employed persons, self-employed businessmen. So all these sectors are classified as priority sectors. So if the government formulates the policy that such and such more amount of credit, more amount of funds should be given, financial assistance should be given to the priority sectors of the economy, then this policy will be carried out through some institutional agencies. And who will implement this policy? Policy will be formulated by the government, but the policy will be implemented. They will be translated into practice by the banks under the supervision of the Reserve Bank of India, which is the central bank of the country. So then the bank will start giving, as per the instruction of the Reserve Bank of India, the commercial banks in the country will extend more amount of lending or credit facilities to the priority sectors such as agriculture, then small business, self-employed businessmen, then housing sector, then traditional industries, village industrial industries like your cottage industries, village industries, then your agricultural sector, etc. So in this way, through policy, rules, regulations, guidelines, also the business activities can be controlled and they can be promoted. So here, the government formulates policies, and the policies usually relate to they will regulate the macroeconomic environment of the business. Macroeconomic environment of the business means, suppose the product market, then the service sector, then suppose the government in a broad area of business activities, the business activities can be controlled, and the microeconomic environment of the business can be controlled or regulated with the help of policy guidelines. Like your rural development, then suppose the government wants to reform the public sector undertakings, banking sectors in the economy, then suppose it will also formulate policy rules, regulations regarding the international trade, import policy, export policy, credit policy, rural development policy, infrastructural development policy, priority sector development policy, isn't it? Then foreign investment policy, then rules and guidelines and policies will be formulated with regard to liberalization, privatization and globalization. What should be, all these are coming under the macroeconomic environment of the business, and the government will have to formulate policy, rules and regulations, and thereby it will be in a position to control the macroeconomic environment of the business through policy framework, policy guidelines. Then institutional agencies, as I was telling you, different institutional agencies will be set up, they will be established. Usually these institutional agencies are established in order to regulate the activities of a particular sector of the economy. For example, the different institutional agencies are your Reserve Bank of India, then IRDA, Insurance Regulatory Development Authority of India, then your TRAI, Telecom Regulatory Authority of India, SEBI, Security and Exchange Board of India. These are certain institutional agencies which have been set up by the government through some special act which have been passed either in the parliament or in any state legislative assembly. Reserve Bank of India has been set up. You must have known. When did the Reserve Bank of India come into existence? Who can tell me? This is a question of general knowledge. As a student of commerce, you should know it. Which is the central bank of our country? Saraswati Sahu?
Reserve Bank of India.
When did the Reserve Bank of India come into existence? First April 1935. 35.
35.
And how did Reserve Bank of India come into existence? By virtue of a special act passed in the year 1934. At that time, Parliament was not there. The lawmaking body at the central level, union level, was known as the General Assembly. So, a special act was passed in the then General Assembly in September 1934. And the act was known as the Reserve Bank of India Act 1934. And by virtue of this act, which was passed in the General Assembly at that time, the Reserve Bank of India came into existence. So, and what is the function of the Reserve Bank of India? It acts as a governing body. It acts as a regulatory body. So it governs and regulates the operations of all the entire banking system in the country are subject to the control, supervision and governance of the Reserve Bank of India. And Reserve Bank of India started functioning with effect from 1st April 1935. So, the Reserve Bank of India, how it regulates the activities of the banking sector? Through its functions. Through its functions. I am just explaining the role of an institutional agency in controlling the activities of a particular sector, banking sector. So I am trying to explain with the help of an example how an institutional agency can play a regulatory role in controlling the activities of the business in a particular sector of the economy. So, Reserve Bank of India regulates the activities in the banking sector through its functions. So, what are the functions of the Reserve Bank of India? How does it work? Yes? Can anybody tell one of the important functions of the Reserve Bank of India? Yes. Kumal Tanwar, are you hearing me? Are you hearing me, Kumal Tanwar? Priyambada Mishra? Hello.
Yes, sir.
Can you tell me one of the functions of the Reserve Bank of India? Okay. Do you have any bank account?
Yes, sir.
Suppose you want to deposit your money, then you will have to go to the bank?
Yes, sir.
And you can also withdraw money from your bank account?
Yes.
So, the government does its banking activity with the Reserve Bank of India. So, the Reserve Bank of India acts as a banker to the government. The Reserve Bank of India acts as a banker to the banks. Your bank is, suppose you are having a savings bank account in State Bank of India. Your bank is State Bank of India. And State Bank of India is a bank, and the bank of the State Bank of India is Reserve Bank. This bank of the government is Reserve Bank. Did you understand?
Yes,
So
sir.
Reserve Bank of India acts as the banker's bank. Reserve Bank of India acts as the banker to the government, and the notes, money is issued by the government of India. Sorry, Reserve Bank of India. Reserve Bank of India or the central bank of the country has the only right to issue notes, monopoly of note issue. It regulates the money supply in the economy through credit control. So credit control is another important functions of the Reserve Bank of India. Similarly, the Reserve Bank of India acts as the custodian of the foreign exchange reserve of our country. The foreign exchange reserve of our country is under the custody of the Reserve Bank of India. So that is how it exercises control. It controls credit. It controls the quantity, the dimension of credit, and the direction of credit. Direction of credit means to which sector credit, more amount of credit will flow. Which sector needs more amount of financial assistance? That has to be decided. That is decided by the government, but that decision is implemented by the central bank. Isn't it? So that is how the banking sectors are controlled and regulated. Banking business is controlled and regulated by the Reserve Bank of India. And the Reserve Bank of India has been empowered to do so by virtue of the provisions which have been given by virtue of the provisions of the Reserve Bank of India Act of 1934. So in this way, institutional agencies are playing a very important role. Another institutional agency is your TRAI. TRAI, what does it do? Telecom Regulatory Authority of India. Its main function is to facilitate the growth of the telecom sector. It will create a level playing field so that there will be fair competition and better quality of customer service in the telecom sector. So the National Telecom Policy of India, the policy has been made by the government of India, but that policy is to be implemented, whether the policy is being properly translated into practice or not. That has to be decided, or that has to be governed or ensued, supervised by the Reserve Bank, sorry, the Telecom Telecom Authority of India, TRAI. So it will create a level playing field so that all the telecom service providers, they will compete, there will be fair competition among them. They will try to improve the quality of service to the customers. They will levy a very fair charge. They will provide the telecom service to the customers at a reasonable price, at a price which is within the financial reach of the common customers, common men. So that is the job of the institutional agency called TRAI, TRAI, Telecom Regulatory Authority of India. It oversees or it ensures the effective implementation of the TRAI. Sorry, telecom policy, National Telecom Policy of India, right? Then IRDA means Insurance Regulatory Development Authority of India. this institutional agency, it was set up in the year 2000. TRAI was started functioning from February 1997. TRAI, the Telecom Regulatory Authority of India. It started functioning from February 1997. But the Insurance Regulatory Development Authority of India, it started functioning since 2000, the year 2000. And what is its function? What is its role? It will decide, it will ensure that all the insurance companies, whether license will be given to the private sector insurance companies or not, whether all the insurance companies which are working in our country, existing in our country, the interest of the policy holders must be duly protected. That has to be ensured by the IRDA, Insurance Regulatory Development Authority of India. Similarly, another institutional agency is your SEBI. SEBI, the Security Exchange Board of India. And Security Exchange Board of India, its objective is, what is its objective? Its objective is to protect the interest of the investors. The investors should not be befooled by the companies. So, their interest must be duly protected, and that has to be ensured by the SEBI. Actually, SEBI was set up by virtue of an act that is known as Security and Exchange Board of India Act 1992. And SEBI Act of 1992 has empowered SEBI to control the activities of the companies, and the it works for the protection of the interest of the investors. So in this way, different institutional agencies are functioning in our country, and they are controlling the business activities. For example, there are many NCERTs there, then UGC is there in the education sector. But we are here discussing about the business environment. How business environment is controlled by different institutional agencies, and how they, what role they are playing, regulatory roles. Then we will come to the basic business law. There are several laws relating to business activities in general and also in specific area and with respect to certain operations, specific operations, several laws are there. And all these laws in our country, what is their role? Their role is to regulate or govern the trade activities, industrial activities, and commercial activities in the country. So all these basic business law, they can be broadly divided into certain categories. Mainly, six categories. The basic business laws can be broadly divided into six categories. Those are basic business law, first category, I will tell you, and in your graduation, those who have done their graduation in commerce, you must have read business law. All of you know business law? Yes. Have you read?
No, sir. Actually, I am a science student, so I am not aware of it.
There is a paper on business law at the graduation level. So, in that business law, basic business laws governing trade, industry, and commercial activities are taught. And the basic business laws are Indian Contract Act 1872, then Indian Sale of Goods Act 1930, Indian Partnership Act 1932, Indian Negotiable Instruments Act 1940, Indian Arbitration Act 1940. So these are the basic business law. And the study of business law actually begins with the study of Indian Contract Act. What is a contract? What is a contract? Is there any commerce student who has? Can you explain me what is the difference between a contract and an agreement? Yes, are ke become padicho ko? Is there any student who has read become? Ki samaste science aur arts ru asi chao mcom karucho?
Yes, sir.
Kie Saraswati.
Again.
Can you tell me what is the difference between an agreement and a contract?
Sir, contract ho chi kichhi ta jinish upare nei ki gote kama kariba. Agreement ho chi ta upare agreement karna ba.
Mone karo tumar bapa tumku gote, suppose your father has given you an assurance or a commitment that
yes,
if you will secure first class in your MCOM examination, he will give you a watch, wrist watch, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Doesn't give you that wrist watch even if you have secured first class in your MCOM examination. Your father will not give you that wristwatch as he has committed to you. So can you sue him in a court of law? Tuma bapanko against you case kariba ki?
No, sir.
Court re?
No, because
no, sir.
Agreement means just a mutual understanding between two parties.
Sir.
Whereas contract means an agreement which is enforceable in a court of law. If two parties will enter into an agreement basing on certain terms and conditions. Those terms and conditions are mutually agreed upon. So if there will be any violations of the terms and conditions by either of the parties, then the other party is empowered to sue the other party in a court of law. So that is known as contract. Contract means an agreement which is enforceable in a court of law. Isn't it? That means,
yes,
if agreement and contract, agreement is not enforceable, it is not legal. Whereas contract is legal in nature. The terms and conditions, that is why it is very often said that all the contracts are agreement, but all agreements are not contracts. So there are different types of contract. And whenever we are doing trading activities, we have to sign. Suppose you are opening a bank account. That means you are entering into a contract with the bank. Banker-customer relationship is the result of a contract. suppose you are taking an insurance policy. Suppose you are taking an insurance policy, then in that case also you are entering into a contract with the insurance company. Suppose you are buying a house from a builder, you are entering into a contractual relationship with the builder. So, and all these contractual relationship are governed as per the provisions of the Indian Contract Act 1872. And if in business activities, we may have to sign contract with the suppliers, we may have to sign contract with the agent. So there is consignment accounting. You must have gone through consignment.
Yes, sir.
Suppose a manufacturer, do you know where the Hero motorcycle are manufactured? Hero motorcycles are manufactured in Haryana. And the owner of the Hero company is Brijmohan Munjal. So, suppose you will buy a Hero bike at Sambalpur or in your own place, then in that case there must be an agent of the manufacturer. The manufacturer does not come and sell the product at your own place. You can get the product from the agent, isn't it? So this agent, principal agent relationship, is also the result of a contract between the manufacturer and the agent or the consignee, isn't it? So in this way, in the normal course of the business, we have to enter into contract, we have to sign contract with so many parties, suppliers, bankers, creditors, then insurance companies, financing companies, isn't it? So these contracts are governed as per the provisions of the Indian Contract Act of 1872. Similarly, Sale of Goods Act, Indian Partnership Act, partnership business. What is a partnership business? Partnership means what? Partnership means the result.
More than one owner.
More
than one owner. Many good.
Partner
ekathi gote business kale partnership business.
Partnership is the result of an agreement between two or more persons who have agreed to share the profit or loss of a business in an agreed ratio, and the business will be carried on by all of them or any one of them. That kind of business is known as partnership business. And the partnership business is governed as per the provisions of the Indian Partnership Act of 1932. Isn't it? So, Partnership Act. Similarly, Negotiable Instruments Act. In course of our business, normal course of our business, we are using checks, bills of exchange, promissory note, documents, isn't it? So all these checks, bills of exchange, promissory notes, they are governed as per the provisions of the Negotiable Instrument Act of 1940. isn't it? So negotiable instruments. Can you give me an example of a negotiable instrument? Check. Check is a negotiable instrument.
Sir, bill of exchange.
Bank draft is also a negotiable instrument. Bank draft. Then 100 rupee currency note, 500 rupee currency note, they are bill of exchange or promissory note. Who can tell me? Bill of exchange is also a negotiable instrument. Promissory note is also a negotiable instrument. 100 rupee currency note. Check is a bill of exchange or a promissory note? अरे इटा तुम्हें अकाउंटिंग रे भी पढ़ी चो और लॉ रे भी पढ़ी चो किंतु कई किसी को ही पारु ना आ मने नहीं की बिल ऑफ एक्सचेंज इज ए प्रॉमिसरी नोट सॉरी बिल ऑफ एक्सचेंज इज ए नेगोशिएबल इंस्ट्रूमेंट प्रॉमिसरी नोट इज आल्सो ए नेगोशिएबल इंस्ट्रूमेंट Example of a bill of exchange. Bill of exchange means an unconditional undertaking to an unconditional order directing certain person to pay a stated sum of money. But promissory note means a promise to pay a certain sum of money. Bill of exchange is an order to pay money. Whereas promissory note is a promise to pay money. Check is a promissory note. Sorry, check is a bill of exchange.
Exchange.
Then bank draft is a bill of exchange. Whereas your can you give me an example of a promissory note? तुम्हें जो 500 टंकिया नोट यूज करूछ से कौन लिखा ही था आई प्रॉमिस टू पे द बियरर ए सम ऑफ 500 रुपीस लिखा ही था कि नहीं
यस सर
किए से लिखी था किए से प्रॉमिस कर था द गवर्नर ऑफ द रिजर्व बैंक
गवर्नर आरबीआई
तो ए करेंसी नोट इज ए प्रॉमिसरी नोट करेंसी नोट इज ए प्रॉमिसरी नोट सो These are basic business laws. Negotiable Instrument Act, Partnership Act, Sales of Goods Act, and Indian Contract Act. Then, the second type of law relating to business activities are Environment Protection Law. Environment Protection Law means there are mainly three types of act: Water Prevention and Control of Pollution Act, 1974. Air Prevention and Control of Pollution Act 1981 and Environment Protection Act of 1986. Then the third type of law relating to business activities are corporate laws. Corporate laws means a joint stock company form of organization, all its activities. Right from the setting up of the company, promotion of the company, expansion of the company, raising of capital, distribution of dividends, conducting meetings, meetings of the shareholders, meeting of the board of directors, then audit of the books of accounts, everything. Winding up of the company, distribution of dividend of the company, liquidation of the company, all the issues relating to the company's activities, corporate activities are subject to the control of the provisions of the Indian Companies Act of 1956 and the latest Company Act is Indian Companies Act of 2013. So the corporate law are again subdivided into several types, which are there in your book, in your study material. It is there. I was going through your study material yesterday. So there are different types of corporate laws. Corporate laws can be classified into 6 or 7 categories. Those are Indian Companies Act, Sikh Industrial Companies Act, then Industrial Development and Regulation Act, MRTP Act. MRTP Act means Monopolies Restrictive Trade Practices Act of 1969, Competition Act 2002, Consumer Protection Act 1986, and Essential Commodities Act of 1955 and 2002. These are the different types of corporate laws which are existing in our country. Similarly, there are securities regulatory laws. That means in the stock market, primary securities and secondary securities are floated. Primary securities means those securities which are being issued for the first time. And secondary securities means the securities which have already been traded in the stock exchange or stock market. So the exchange of securities, buying and selling of securities, like your bond, government securities, then securities issued by the company, shares issued by the companies, they are governed as per the provisions of an act. That act is known as Securities Contract Regulation Act of 1956 or SEBI Act. SEBI Act also is there, Security Exchange Board of India Act. Actually, Securities Contract Regulation Act is there. That act has been passed in the Parliament in the year 1956. And the adequate implementation, proper implementation of the provisions of the Securities Contracts Regulation Act are supervised by the SEBI, Security Exchange Board of India. That means when shares and securities are purchased and sold, bought and sold in the security market, whether they are being traded, giving due consideration to the interest of the investors or not, that has to be ensured by the SEBI. And SEBI has been given this power as per the provisions laid down in the Security and Exchange Board of India Act of 1992. Similarly, one more kind of law relating to business activities are labor laws. And in labor law, different acts are there. Factories Act, Payment of Wages Act, Payment of Bonus Act, Payment of Gratuity Act, all these acts are coming under labor laws. Then Workmen Compensation Act, Industrial Disputes Act, Trade Union Act, then Employees Provident Fund Act, Payment of Gratuity, Payment of Bonus, Payment of Wages, Factory Act, Industrial Disputes Act. All these acts are coming under labor laws, and they are designed mainly, they contain provisions mainly to protect the interest of the labor class, and at the same time that they are no injustice is done to them. They are being given proper wages, compensation, proper working environment, they are working on favorable and acceptable terms and conditions. These are ensured under different labor laws. Then, in addition to these acts, labor laws, there are several other also regulatory laws, miscellaneous regulatory laws. For example, there is an act known as Standards, Weight and Measures Act 1956. That means this act is to protect the interest of the customers or the farmer. Suppose whenever the customer is assured, he has a right to get the right quantity of products, right quantity of the goods, and that has to be ensured through this act, Standards, Weights and Measures Act 1956. Similarly, Patent Act is also there. Patent means it is an intangible asset. Intangible asset, intangible fixed asset. In accounting, patent means what? It is an intangible fixed asset. It is also subject to depreciation. But the word depreciation is not used. When you are going to depreciate an intangible assets, intangible fixed assets, the term depreciation is not used. Which term is used? Who can say? Depreciation of intangible fixed assets. There is one word. Who can say what is that word? Yes. Amortization, that is known as amortization. So, Patents Act of 1970, then Trademarks Act. Trademark means a brand which is registered under the provisions of the Trademark Act of 1999. That means all trademarks are brands, but all brands are not trademarks. A brand which is registered with the government under the provisions of the Trademarks Act 1999 is known as a trademark. Similarly, FEMA. FEMA stands for Foreign Exchange Management Act of 1999. Foreign Exchange Management Act. Then Trade and Commercial Commodities Marketing Act of 1959, Agricultural Product Grading and Marketing Act 1959. Then there are several laws existing in our country, in which are in force in our country. They control the activities of pharmaceutical industries, banking industry. For controlling the activities of the banking company, Reserve Bank of India Act is there, but there is also Banking Regulation Act of 1949. Banking Regulation Act of 1949 is there. Insurance Act of 1938 is there. Electricity Supply Act is there. There is law relating to carriage of goods. Law relating to carriage of goods. So these are the different or miscellaneous regulatory laws which are commonly found to be in implementation, in use, in course of the normal activities of the business enterprises. So this is all about the legal aspects of business environment and the different types of laws and to put it in a nutshell. What we have discussed today, let me summarize it in 4 to 5 sentences. Number one, government plays 4 types of rule as far as the legal aspects of business environment is concerned. Those are planning, role of planning means formulation of policy, guidelines, norms, etc. Planning role, then promotional role, entrepreneurial role, and regulatory role. 4 types of roles are being
sir made. Entrepreneurial role to kya hota hai?
Entrepreneurial role means government should promote entrepreneurship development in the country. Why it is essential? Entrepreneur means, what do you mean by an entrepreneur? A person who is self-employed. He has his own business. He is a self-employed person. He does not depend on private sector or government sector for earning his livelihood. He is a self-employed independent person. He has his own business. Instead of seeking employment, he provides employment. He not only engages himself in the business activities, he also provides, he runs his own business, but he also provides employment to some people to help in the conduct of his business, doing something independently. Why it is important in a country like India? Because here the scope for wage employment is very limited. Samaste jadi ame koibe sabu pilla mane koibe ame wage employment karibu ame chakri karibu, is it possible? No. There are many people, all businessmen, all independent businessmen, they are entrepreneurs, small industrialists, small or big industrialists, self-employed businessmen, even auto drivers, they are called as entrepreneurs. They are doing their own business. They are self-employed persons.
Yes, so, sir.
Government will have to promote entrepreneurship because there is a promotion of small enterprises requires less amount of capital, but it provides employment to more number of people. So small enterprises have greater employment potential, but they are less capital intensive. They need small amount of investment. So that is fit, that is in conformity with the basic characteristics of the Indian economy, which is characterized by scarcity of capital and surplus labor. So that is why entrepreneurship must be promoted by the government. Entrepreneurial rule, it should promote self-employment, it should create self-employment opportunities so that by providing financial assistance, by providing technical assistance, providing subsidy, concessions, government can play entrepreneurial role. Did you understand? Then regulatory role through implementation of different laws, rules, acts, statutes. Isn't it? So this is how government plays 4 types of role as far as the legal aspects of business environment is concerned. And there are 3 types of agencies. That means the legal aspects of business environment or the government or the legal aspects of business environment consisting each consisting of 3 types. Number one is government policy. Number two is institutional agencies. Number three is common business law. So about which we have already discussed elaborately. So you go through these topics. If you are having any doubt anywhere, you can ask me, note it down, and you can ask me now. And yes, now it is open for you. You can ask me if you are having doubts anywhere on the topic which we have covered so far, today, yesterday, and the day before. Hello. Yes. Hello. Learners, are you hearing me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, you can now question, ask your doubts. You see, you make some self-study at home. You do some homework. Then only you can have doubts.
Yes, sir.
Because business environment is a very vast topic. Just 1 minute. Be online. I am coming within 1 minute. As I was telling you, you must come prepared with, that means you do some homework. Tomorrow, suppose you can ask me questions on this legal environment, legal aspects of business environment, different types of business environment, social responsibilities of business, significance of business environment. All the topics we have already discussed.
Yes, sir. So we have, sir, discussed two topics, na? Social political environment and the legal environment.
No, you see, we here we are not supposed to discuss each and every point which are there in your study material.
Yes, sir, understand.
IGNU study materials are, they are known as SLM, self-learning study materials. They have been prepared in such a manner that you can make, you can go through them and self-study. By through self-study, you will be, you are supposed to acquire knowledge. So these counseling classes are meant for clearing your doubts. But when doubts will come, only when you will make some self-study. So you go through your study material on all the topics which we have covered during over last 3 days. And you, if you are having any doubt anywhere, you note them. You jotted them in your notebook and you can ask me. Yes. In course of my discussion, I was telling you that banker-customer relationship is the result of a contract between the banker and the customer. Isn't it? So, what are the different types of relationship that exist between a banker and a customer? And how it is a contractual relationship? Can you explain? What are the different types of relationship that exist between a banker and a customer? Debtor-creditor relationship. Suppose you are having an account in the bank and you have deposited some amount of money in your bank account. Then in that case, your creditor, bank is the debtor. Bank will give you loan. Bank will give you interest. And when you are, suppose you have taken an advance from the bank. Then in that case, the banker is the creditor and you are the debtor. So debtor-creditor relationship is one type of relationship, and that is a contractual relationship. So whenever you are doing any kind of business, हेलो यस देयर वाज सम डिसरप्शन सो आई वाज एक्सप्लेनिंग यू अबाउट द बैंकर कस्टमर रिलेशनशिप सो व्हेन एवर यू आर डूइंग ए बिजनेस You may have to carry out transactions with your bank. So thereby you are entering into a contractual relationship with the bank. You are signing, whenever you are opening an account in the bank, you are bound by a contractual relationship with the bank. So besides this debtor and creditor relationship, what other kind of relationship can exist between a banker and a customer? Can you share with your, on the basis of your experience? Yes. Suppose you are depositing, sometimes we are taking a locker on hiring basis, safe deposit locker. You are keeping your valuables, gold, bullion, jewelries, important documents in a locker. And in order to take a locker, you have to pay higher charges. So in that case, what is the kind of relationship existing between the banker and the customer? When you are keeping your valuables, gold, jewelries with the bank, does the bank becomes the owner of those properties? Yes. Simply those articles are under the custody of the bank. Are you listening to me?
Yes, sir.
तुम्हें जिते बड़े तुम्हार सुना गहना बैंक रे रखी दौ लॉकर रे बैंक कौन से सुना गहना रो मालिक हो गला कि
नो सर
त बैंक रो कस्टडी रे तुम्हें रखी देलो बैंक रो हिफाजत रे तुम्हें रखी देलो
यस सर
व्हाट इज द रिलेशनशिप दैट इज एग्जिस्टिंग बिटवीन द बैंकर एंड द कस्टमर सेटा होची ट्रस्टी बेनिफिशियरी रिलेशनशिप ट्रस्टी बेनिफिशियरी रिलेशनशिप यू आर द बेनिफिशियरी बैंक इज द ट्रस्टी एज द ट्रस्टी द बैंक इज कीपिंग योर आर्टिकल्स वैल्यूएबल्स प्रॉपर्टीज अंडर इट्स सेफ कस्टडी सिमिलरली ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ द कस्टमर योर बैंक विल पे योर इलेक्ट्रिसिटी बिल Bank will pay your insurance premium, electricity bill, etc. Then in that case, the relationship that exists between the banker and the customer is principal-agent relationship. So all these are contractual relationship. So in this way, whenever a business enterprise will be established, it will have to enter into relationship with so many outside agencies. Contractual relationship, and that will be governed by the Indian Contract Act of 1872. So, thank you. I think all of them have left.
Yes, sir.
Okay, bye.
Thank you, sir.
पटेल बाबू
इज इंटरप्रेटेड थ्रू हर आईज शी इंटरप्रेट थिंग्स पीपल इवेंट्स देयर हैज टू बी आई मीन्स देयर इज बायस इन द नरेशन
हेलो
पटेल बाबू
हां सर
सॉरी अल्का
हां सर थैंक यू सर
ओके
Thanks a lot, sir. Thank you.